how people have studied dietary patterns. It really limits the ability of this advisory committee to draw any firm conclusions about the health benefits of certain dietary patterns. And so I was sitting there and thinking, this problem is actually fixable because the data exists. There are lots of wonderful cohort studies with extensive nutritional data. The problem is that everybody sits in their own office, advised by their particular biostatistician, uses a slightly different technique, and at the end you can't really compare the results. And to just give you a quick overview of the range of methods that are used, they fall into what is called a priori methods, which includes the indices and scores like the DASH index, you might have heard of, or the health and eating index. And then there are a couple of other variations on those, the confirmatory factor analysis approach also is an a priori method. And then there are all these exploratory methods, cluster analysis, principal components analysis, reduced rank regression sort of in the middle area. And the vast majority of research at the time had been done in that right-hand side of the slide under the exploratory method. So everybody was using a different technique, different procedures within the technique. Fewer people were using indices and scores, but even with the indices and scores, everybody had their favorite index. You know, there's the AGI, there's the alternate AGI, there's the Mediterranean index, there's the alternate Mediterranean index, and the list goes on and on. So I was sitting at that meeting, and I thought, yes, this is fixable. And so I talked to the USDA and suggested, how about you organize a consortium of investigators who would be willing to run some standardized analyses in their large data set. You get them all together, we agree on the protocol, and we run it in the data sets. So, needless to say, I was not heard at that meeting. There was too much else going on, and they had an action-packed agenda. But a few months later, I ran into a lot of the same colleagues from the National Cancer Institute who had attended the meeting at a scientific meeting, and I just voiced that idea again. And there they heard me. And they actually got so excited about the idea that they said, we're going to put some effort into this. We're going to call this the Dietary Patterns Methods Project. And I think it's a slight misnomer now, but that's OK. We're going to try to find a group of investigators, nutritional epidemiologists around the country who want to get together, who have access to really large data sets, and we want to analyze these in a consistent manner so that the results of this will directly inform the 2015 dietary guidelines. And that's what we did. So I want to spend just a little bit of time on sort of the process and the methods of what we did, and then I'll share some results with you. But I felt like the process is a little bit important because this was basically an unfunded project where NCI's put in a lot of in-kind support. You know, their staff, their postdocs did a lot of this. And then they had people like myself and a few others who just donated their time and were willing to spend quite a bit of time on this. So without the NCI, I don't think we could have done this because especially I'm forever indebted to Jill Reedy, who managed the process. She kept us on task. Her head of her division, Sue Prep Smith, was completely in love with this project and let Jill have free reign. And then there were other people like Amy Subar, who lent her invaluable expertise on methods. And Stephanie George was a postdoc at NCI at the same time, and the other two were as well. Stephanie actually ended up writing one of the quote papers. So if these women had not been able and willing to volunteer their time for this effort, it would never have come about. Because we did consider writing a sort of a joint grant application. You know how that goes. So we would still be submitting applications if that had been the path chosen. So the first step was to identify the cohorts who would actually want to participate. And so NCI thought big, and these were the inclusion criteria. They wanted at least 5,000 5,000 deaths to have accrued over the follow-up period of the cohort. They wanted at least 10 years of follow-up period, detailed ascertainment of causes of death, of course, and an important inclusion criteria. They wanted the cohorts to not only have extensive dietary assessment, but a validation sub-study against either 25 recalls or dietary records. And also the capacity of the data to be linked to something called the MyPyramid equivalent database. So that, of course, eliminated quite a few cohorts that are out there. And in hindsight, I think we could certainly expand this effort if we were willing to live without the validation sub-study, because that's absolutely a really limiting step. So few large cohorts have ever done that. So the NCI, and consulted with myself and several others about who to approach, and approached quite a few cohort efforts in the United States. And the three ended up at the table willing to participate, sort of on the terms of, this is basically you volunteering your time, right? where the multi-ethnic cohort in Hawaii, the Women's Health Initiative, observational study, and several investigators there. And then the NIH AARP Diet and Health Study is already situated at NIH, and they have direct access to it. So these are very large cohort efforts, as you can see. And they had extensive food frequency-based dietary assessment. So the investigators that were involved were Carol Boucher, the lead investigator from the University of Hawaii, and she had a couple of postdocs, were Carmen and Renelette Etienne at the time, who really helped tremendously, and Brooke ended up writing one of the papers. And then Mary Neuhauser at the Fred Hutch was just instrumental in navigating WHI for us and making sure we followed all those policies carefully. And then, you know, me in South Carolina. No cohort there. So the leadership by the NCI was critical. Without this, we couldn't have done it. Jill organized weekly meetings, agendas, action items, all of these things that keep us accountable, especially important when we're doing volunteer work, basically. We were very mindful of all the different cohorts had different publication policies, and of course we had to adhere to them, so we put into place what we needed. We had got some input from external reviewers at key junctures, because we wanted to have really defensible science at the end of the day. And we had some very clear goals. We wanted publications ready, or for presentation at least, at the ASN meetings, and this was April 2014. And then there was a guideline group that was convened in June of 2014. So we really had to hop to it. And so we batted around the idea of which dietary indices to use. We very early on said we're going to go index-based, because that's what's part of the dietary guidelines already. The dietary guidelines mentions the healthy eating index and the Mediterranean diet score, and it mentions the DASH index, so definitely include those. And then there were many variations on these, and we swapped through them and came to consensus as to which to include. So we ended up with these four indices that we explored. And then we set ourselves very clear sort of guidelines on how standardized we wanted to be, and it was very standardized. I mean, we developed coding algorithms, not at the level of SAS, a programmer did that, but we developed very clear instructions on which food group would go into which category for all of the food frequency questionnaires that we were using, so that there was harmonization across the three cohorts. We discussed at length exclusion criteria, inclusion criteria for the three cohorts, very different populations, so you have to think about this, and we use the same criteria as far as possible. We did the same for covariates. We decided how covariates would be categorized. And as you can see, like, the list of covariates is identical for all cohorts, except for hormone replacement therapy. That's specific to the WHI. And then the NCI programmer wrote code for all of this and shared it across the cohort. So two of the three analyses were done at NCI, one was done in Hawaii. So it was really critical that everybody was working off the exact same protocol. That was the whole purpose. And we had this goal of publishing three cohort-specific papers, and then one to the cross-cohort synthesis paper, and hopefully to get all of this done by the time for the Dietary Guideline Advisory Committee to review this prior to their report. That did not fully work out, but it was good. So I'll talk a little bit about the results of the synthesis paper that I wrote. There were four questions, and I'm only going to share with you like a snapshot of results for two of those questions. The first question here, and the question three on this slide. And then I'll briefly walk you through those results and just tell you a little bit about what we're doing now. So I wanted to start with just sharing a little bit about the demographic differences between the cohorts and a little bit about dietary intake and then the event rates that had been observed in different cohorts, because that of course would really matter. So there were some things about the cohorts that were very similar. For instance, all three cohorts were started in the same calendar time period, and they all recruited middle-aged to older adults. Two of the cohorts included both genders. WHI is of course all focused on young women. All cohorts, so WHI and ARP are mostly white populations. MEC is the only study of the three that had a sizable multi-ethnic component. In terms of educational levels, there were actually quite some differences with the WHI population being the most educated, the MEC population being the least educated. That was true for women, and for men, the ARP was more educated than men. Marital status varied quite a bit across the cohorts again. The proportion of never smokers was more similar, fortunately, across cohorts than not. Here you see some event rates. These are total mortality, so death rates, CVD mortality, cancer mortality in the three panels. For women in red, men in blue, and the pairs of columns represent the different studies, so it's ARP first, MEC second, WHI third. And you can see that for total mortality, ARP and MEC have pretty similar event rates, WHI much lower. Same pattern held for CVD mortality, much lower CVD mortality, WHI, than in the other female cohorts. Cancer mortality, things were more. And then in terms of the diet quality, intake quality, I'm just showing you a graph for the mean HEI scores, Healthy Eating Index 2010. So the score runs from 0 to 100. And you can see that at the, and so what we're plotting is the mean at each one of the quintiles of the HEI distribution in the basically five cohorts, three female cohorts to male. And you can see that in the basically anywhere between quintile 2 and 5, the mean intake levels, the quality of the intake was very similar. But at the bottom end, there's more variation, interestingly. So that just for some background info. And that brings me to sort of the key results of all the three papers and the synthesis paper, which is the question of, is diet quality consistently associated with lower all-cause mortality, with lower cardiovascular mortality, and lower cancer mortality? And if so, at what rank, you know, of dietary quality do we start seeing those impacts? So I'm going to show you a series of slides that are all set up like this one here. It basically shows you hazard ratios on a plot. For the three cohorts, ARP, MEC, WHI, from left to right. The little symbols designate different diet quality index scores that we use. So red is HEI, green is AHEI, the next one, and then ABED and DASH. And this first slide is for all-cause mortality in women. The next one will be all-cause mortality in men. And what you're seeing is the hazard ratio associated with intake in the top quintile. So the highest quality diet compared to the lowest quality diet. And the difference, basically, or the impact on all-cause mortality. So you see this in a protective effect, that higher diet quality was associated with a lower hazard of dying, lower risk of dying. And the really neat thing that we had really not anticipated, we were expecting the results to be all over the map, is that you can see how the point estimates are very similar across all cohorts and across all four quality indices. And that was the part we were trying to, I don't want to say try to prove, but that was our hope, that these indices actually relate to similar strength of association. So we saw this consistency for all-cause mortality in women, for all four diet quality indices. We saw the same thing in men for all-cause mortality. Here, of course, we have only two cohorts, but still very consistent findings. When we looked at CVD mortality, we again saw a nice inverse association with high-quality diet being associated with lower, low risk of CVD mortality. And again, very consistent across the four quality indices and across the cohorts. Confidence intervals, of course, getting much wider because the sample size, the number of cases is going down. So this was the result in women for CVD mortality. And very similar result, maybe a little bit more heterogeneous for CVD mortality in men. And that brings us to cancer mortality. And this was actually the only time where we saw one inconsistency in the entire project, which is remarkable. So for cancer mortality in women, findings were very consistent within the ARP study and the MEC study. Again, very similar hazard ratios across all four quality indices. In the WHI, this was not true for the AHEI 2010. It did not reach statistical significance. The point estimates of the other three and the other confidence intervals were very consistent again. But then in men, we're back to the very consistent pattern. So we have actually not really solved, I have to admit, the mystery of this one. Why is this one index not associated with cancer mortality in this one cohort? I still can't answer that question, but I guess you just have to have one consistent finding and another has very consistent study. So the other thing we did, and these are very simplistic thoughts, we plotted the hazard ratios across the sort of quintile distribution, and you can see that this is just for the HEI 2010 as an example, that with sort of increasing diet quality, we saw this very nice linear decrease in risk of what are we looking at in the top panels, mortality, all-cause mortality, and CVD mortality. The cancer mortality was just not as consistent. So just to summarize briefly, I think for us, the real the blessing of this study in many ways, because it could have gone very differently. We were prepared for all kinds of heterogeneity in our data. But the surprising result was that we found this amazing consistency, that diet quality, regardless of how we measured it with these four tools, and there are only four, and there are many others out there, but they're the most commonly used, that high diet quality is really consistently associated with lower all-cause mortality, lower CVD mortality, and for the most part, lower cancer mortality. And we found that this benefit, if you can infer benefit from an epidemiologic study, which you really can't, but that this trend sort of started at the second quintile already. So any kind of improvement in diet quality seemed to confer some kind of improvement in mortality outcome. So the publications are all out there listed here. The three cohort-specific publications were out first. And then the synthesis paper, it of course needed the other analysis to be completed before I could write about those. But it followed shortly thereafter. And at least we got preprint versions of these to the Dietary Guidelines Advisory Committee. The ARP and the WHI paper were actually in print at the time the DGAC met. The other two were still in review, so that was not quite how we wanted it, but then again, we did it all on shoestring. So. Since we completed that first stab at collaboration, the codes that we developed have been shared with numerous other investigators, and a lot of papers have been published, some within the cohorts, and then others in different investigative groups have said, well, then I want to use this methodology and apply it to my own cohort. So that's really nice. And the National Cancer Institute had a little web page put up where we have contact information in the publications, and people can reach the NCI and us if they want more information. So that's really helpful. What we're doing now is we took kind of a little bit of a break after getting those first four papers out. And then there was a little bit of a brainstorming phase as to what do we do now, because we had gotten so used to working with each other on a weekly basis that we started thinking, oh, this is how life is going to continue, right? That we need a new idea. And we didn't have that new idea yet. I mean, we have an idea and we're working it together again, but at a different pace.